All right. For liquid vapor mixtures, about the only way to really know what you're doing with things is, as we've seen, with the thermodynamic tables, those tables in the back of the book. They also, in certain places, come in gigantic charts with lines all over. They have to be gigantic because they cram so much in there. Or use E's, but those are all basically the same thing. Somebody somewhere has done all of these tests, tabulated all of this, graphed all of it, and so somewhere we have all of those tables. There's not really any other way to come up with some of those values. However, out here in the superheat region, especially in this general region, well, not even farther up than that, at relatively low pressures, and by relatively low, I mean as compared to those values at the critical point. So at low pressures, quite a bit less than critical, and at temperatures that are generally higher than critical, and the higher the temperatures, the better this works. We do have some ways to make some calculations on some of these properties and how they are related. Most of you have heard of it. It's called the ideal gas relation. If we're far enough away from the dome, then we can treat the fluid as an ideal gas. Couple qualifications before you can use it. It must be a gas. Two, it must not be a liquid. Liquids aren't gases. Three, no part liquid. This doesn't work under the dome. It doesn't work to the left of the dome. It doesn't work very close to the dome. It's a gas relation. It's a gas law. Some of you are snickering and grinning at me, wondering what. Teaching this over the years, I've seen people time and time again use the ideal gas law under the dome. There's liquid there. If you can convince me liquid is the same as a gas in all ways, I'll be happy to accept full credit for that. But good luck convincing me of that. So we have this ideal gas law at particular relative restrictions and goes basically like that. Comes in a whole bunch of flavors, but that's probably the simplest one. The only thing that's new here, a couple warnings. This must be absolute pressure. That's far and away the pressure we work with in our problems. If any problem just says some particular pressure, it's absolute because it doesn't mention anything else about a gauge or some kind of measurement. Of course, this is the specific volume. Couldn't have waited to throw that away. Just wanted to be on camera.
Yeah.
The temperature must also be in absolute. From the absolute temperature scale, that's usually Kelvin, but could be Rankine if we're doing any English problems. And then this is the gas constant. That's probably, well, that plus making sure you have temperature in absolute degrees is probably the trickiest part of it. But the absolute gas constant, or not the app, sorry, the just the gas constant itself. Well, I don't want to turn that thing on because it makes so much noise. Never mind, I don't need to show you, you know what it looks like. It's right there, the first table in the back of the book, table A1, has right in it the gas constants for particular gases. It does list one for water. And it does say the word water rather than H2O or liquid. So students do at times think that that automatically means it can apply for any kind of liquid state. It's not true. It's just the colloquial word water that we use no matter what the state. But these are gas constants. And for water, for example, it's 0.4615. And the units are kilojoules, kilogram per degree K. It's got a little note here just to help you, just so you know what how awesome some of this stuff can be. That's equivalent to units of kilopascals, meters cubed per kilogram degree K. That makes a little more sense because then when you have those units, it fits in just right with everything you've got there. Better than kilojoules does. So those units make a little bit more sense just in terms of the equation as it's up on the board. All right, you've most seen that before from at least from high school chemistry probably if nowhere else. Yeah. And it's just a matter of being careful with the units. That's the biggest deal. If you skip the units on this, you're going to get all screwed up. Because this comes in several different flavors. For example, what it turns out is if you multiply R, the gas constant, times M, the molecular weight, if you do that for all the gases, and you can check that with that table A1, just go down there and do this, you get what's called the universal gas constant. That product for all gases, the gas constant for that gas times its molecular weight gives you the universal gas constant. And thus, since it's universal, there's only one of those. So you can make the equation a little bit simpler by putting in the universal gas constant. I'll give you some of the different forms of that in a minute or two. This is the one that's a little bit trickier in terms of, well, it's not trickier in getting the units right. All you have to do is read what the units are, and you'll get it right. But this one is, I don't know where it is. Is it in the back of your book? Oh, I got my book here. I believe it's in the back of the book. This is the set of tables I put on. Well, yeah, it doesn't have the last tables. I've considered appendices, so that's just appendices. Just inside the back cover of the book is the universal gas constant in several different sets of units. For example, the most typical form we'll use it in, 31447 kilopascals meters cubed. Not kilogram, but kilogram moles, degrees K. So you know the number of moles in the problem rather than the
you don't want it in that form, the kilogram ones. No, they're all on a per basis. So yeah, I guess the essence is since you're on a per basis. Oh. I've got to go ahead and reject. Don't mind me, guys. Make yourself at home, huh? Okay. values we can use then to look off the compressibility chart. So see how you do with those. I think that's about 0.4. And this is about 1.6. So 1.6, that means we need the table, the big chart. Man size chart. Okay, so that helps you. And the dark lines going across here are the temperature lines. The dotted lines are the volume lines. We don't have volume. Looking for volume here. Oh yeah, sorry, I was looking at that one. Reduced pressure is 0.4, yeah. Oh man, see this is bad because the 0.4 line doesn't go anywhere. We don't know any more than 0.4. Temperature lines are the dark ones that go across here. So we want to go to 4 up to what? 1.6. That's right there, it looks like. Friday.